Hey guys, how are you doing today? Welcome back to my channel. This is the Littlebean and Me podcast channel. I'm Kayleen, I'm your host. I am the resident fiber artist and yarn dyer behind Littlebean Crochet on Etsy and Littlebean Loves hand-painted yarn. I do all the fiber related things like crocheting and knitting and spinning and dyeing. This is mostly a dyeing podcast where I kind of talk about the yarns that I've been dyeing and ideas that I have about dyed yarns, and then also the things that I make with them, whether it's my own or other people's yarns. I've also been doing tons of spinning lately, so today we're going to talk a little about spinning. But I hope you guys are all well. I hope you all, if you're in the United States, I hope you've enjoyed the Thanksgiving celebrations that were last week. I didn't do a podcast last week, mostly because I was busy doing dyeing for the large shop update on Small Business Saturday, which was great. Thank you, everybody, for your support. Whether you purchased anything or not, or just liked, shared, commented on any posts that I made, I really appreciate everything. So I was doing that last week. And so I didn't film a podcast, and we had Thanksgiving and the whole shenanigans, and we hosted, so it was kind of, we were busy. So welcome to everybody who's returning. If you're brand new, we've had a ton of new subscribers. Welcome to the channel. I hope you enjoy this little podcast. I always try and keep it a little bit on the shorter side, closer to 30 to 45 minutes, only because, well, I have to edit this whole thing and do it all during a 3-hour nap period. So I try and keep it a little shorter. So welcome. Today we're gonna talk about spinning, which you'll see here, and we're gonna talk about some cool knitting and some dyeing and some crochet, which is back here. I realize you can't see it. My whole head is blocking that. Let me fix it. There we go. Now you can see the pretty project. Let's just get into everything. I don't have any active works in progress right now. I just have some finished objects. So at the beginning, I think I showed you a little bit of footage, some of the hand spun that I did, some of the process that I'm doing with dyeing this week. And so I guess we'll just get into spinning. So spinning this week has been really fun. I received my wheel from Sheena. Hi Sheena, if you're watching. I purchased her wheel used. She was destashing because she got a brand new wheel. And so I asked her and I said, are you interested in selling? She said yes. So she had posted it up in one of the yarn groups and I said, you know, I'd be really interested in buying it. Let's chat. So we chatted about it. It's a Babe production wheel, which I'll pop the picture here for you. It's a single treadle. It's a bobbin spun, so the bobbin will drive. The bobbin is what is on the thing. This is how much I know about spinning. Okay, so there's the treadle, which makes the big wheel turn, and that big wheel is connected to the bobbin. So the bobbin will spin really fast, and then the flyer, you can adjust the tension on the flyer with a leather strap. I forget what kind of tension that's called, and if you know it, then you should please put it in the comments because I don't remember. But anyway, so I figured everything out because I've been doing the drop spindling, and so I had a premise on how everything worked. So the day that it came, my swap present also came from Fine Yarn Connoisseurs. I'm participating in a Christmas swap there, and so I was very happy that it arrived when it did because I didn't have to open my present right away and be a D-bag and ruin the surprise of Christmas because I was more preoccupied with this brand new wheel, or new to me wheel. So I immediately started practicing spinning and I was getting, you know, used to the uptake. So when you are spinning on a wheel, you know, the flyer spins around the bobbin while the bobbin is spinning and they spin at different rates. So that you can, the yarn will actually feed onto the bobbin. And so I was playing a lot with the tension on the flyer to have a better uptake, and I was practicing my treadling speed and my drafting speed because it's a little bit like a dance or like music where you have to have a certain rhythm. I also play the flute. I'm a flautist. I've been playing the flute for a very long time, since I was 10 years old, and I haven't picked it up in quite a while because of the kids and I just don't feel like practicing. I'd rather do other things right now. But anyway, it's like having that certain rhythm in your head when you're playing music or singing music, when you're spinning on a wheel. You have that same sense of rhythm where you're pumping the treadle, whether it's a single or a double treadle, and then the rhythm at which you're drafting out your fibers. So it's a really fun and relaxing type thing. I think I spun through like 8 ounces of fiber in a single day because I was sitting there just like, oh my god, I have to get this right. So I spun through some purple dyed fiber that I had dyed quite a long time ago when I started drop spindling. I had a full 4 ounce braid of that, so I used that as my first spin. I also spun up some of the Rolags, the green Rolags that I got from Battersville Farm, which I had showed, I think, on last podcast. I had it on the drop spindle, but I thought this would be perfect to practice drafting because I didn't care if the yarn was perfect. I was just going to use it mostly for practice. And then I spun up some of the other Vattersfeld Rolags, which were the Fall Festival, which came out great. I have a sampling here, which I'll show you in a second. And then I spun up this gorgeous pink beauty. This was some new fiber that I had gotten from Amanda of the ClassySquid Fiber Company. And I forget the name of the colorway. It's like Rose Petals or Rose Garden or something, but it's vibrant pink and beautiful. So I spun up those things. I started spinning the purple and the green, and then I was practicing different methods of plying. So I really like Navajo ply on the drop spindle. I find it very easy, very intuitive how things work. So doing it on the spinning wheel was a whole different animal, and I was really, really, really struggling with uptake. I was plying the fibers and it just wasn't going into the bobbin, going into the flyer and then onto the bobbin. So I was really adjusting tension. I failed at that. So that the first yarns that I had were very overspun and very, you know, messed up. I got to the green fiber. I had spun that and I plied it. I did a 2-ply, which was very easy to do on the wheel, because you have the lazy Kate, which is on the bottom. It's just holes that are done into the bottom of the spinning wheel, the bottom of the spinning wheel, so you can put your bobbins on like sticks, and then the bobbins freely rotate while you can feed the plying process into the wheel. So that was much easier. I did do a 2-ply and my son destroyed it. So I was going to show that 2-ply to you, but it was very easy. I found that very, very, very easy. So then I decided, okay, well, now I really need to practice doing a 3-ply because I really like Navajo ply. I think it looks really nice. I think it stitches up really nicely. And so with the Fall Festival, I'll show you this. So I spun this on the wheel. I tried. So my goal with spinning right now is always to do as thinly as possible and as consistently as possible. So whatever width I can get the yarn to be consistent is the width that I'm spinning. I'm trying to be very mindful of that because I don't want to just have this lumpy bummy art yarn. I'm really trying to refine my process and to get better at what I'm doing, because I find it easy to make blobs in the yarn. I find it difficult to really have a nice smooth outcome. So I spun this up. Here it is. Cover my face. Okay, here we go. My phone is blinking at me. Why is it blinking at me? Here we go. All right, so here's the yarn. It is not perfect. It is Navajo plied. I was able to adjust the tension of the wheel to actually get the ply to work. You can see there are a lot of overspun bits. There are a lot of fluff that's happening in here. There's some really chunky bits. So I thought that this was a success. It's not perfect, but I'm extremely proud of it because it was the first real yarn that I spun off of my wheel. And so for my giftee, for Fine Yarn Connoisseur, they sent off her present, but I just crocheted a simple ornament out of this hand spun because I'm so proud of it and I hope she likes it. It's, you know, all fall colors. It's all lumpy and bumpy and I don't even care, but I'm very proud of this yarn. Okay, sorry about the interruption. I was getting texts. My husband took the day off today. It's his birthday and he is out shopping, so he's texting me, and then I have my cousin texting me. Why is everybody texting me? Everybody always texts me when I'm busy. Okay, so talking about spinning. So then, because I wanted to get good, I wanted to get better at what I was doing before I attempted to truly spin 4 ounces. So this is a full 4 ounce bundle that I spun up from Amanda. And so, again, this is not perfect. And there are parts that are kind of overspun and parts, like, not severely overspun. Like this, I got very much better with this. And this is a Polworth silk blend. I'm sorry, I didn't mention that. This is Polworth silk. So I really love spinning with Polworth. This might be my favorite fiber to spin. I like merino also. I'm not a super fan of BFO. I've been finding it hard to draft. So this is my yarn. It is probably around 100 yards. So it's a nice bulky weight. But again, it's not perfect. So when I started this, I was afraid to Navajo ply because of the disasters that happened with this, even though I was still practicing. And I'm like, oh, I just want to spin this. So I spun it on 2 bobbins. I split the braid in half. I tried to split it evenly. So I weighed it on the scale and tried to get an even split. And then I felt pretty good about the initial spin, and I knew it was going to be a little thick and thin, a little chunky, a little uneven. So then I go to ply it, and I'm having the same problem on my wheel that I was having before, where my tension wasn't tight enough to have a stronger uptake. So I was trying to ply the yarn and it wasn't going in, and I was getting really frustrated. So I decided I was going to 2-ply because I was really nervous about Navajo plying, because I knew I could 2-ply well on the wheel, and I was a lot more nervous about Navajo ply. And so I started plying, and finally got the tension right, and it's pulling in the yarn, but I'm not allowing the yarn to really spin up. So as you're treadling in the opposite direction that you spun, and you have the 2 fibers going in. When you're holding the yarn and not allowing it to go in, it's building the twist. And so I wasn't holding it long enough to build enough twist for the speed that I was treadling. So again, that's the rhythm that I'm talking about. It's like you're treadling and then you're pulling and feeding the fiber in and letting it twist on itself. So this is for plying. So there's parts of this that are underplied. And so I'm gonna show you what underplying looks like. So this part of the yarn is severely underplied, and it was because when I was treadling, I was not treadling fast enough for the speed at which I was plying. And I didn't realize it until I had done it like 4 or 5 times, so that's a pretty significant chunk. And I knew it would kind of even out. It's not, you know, it's not the worst underplying ever. You can see here how it's a little separated. But after I plied overall, it was relatively balanced. And then once I soaked it, kind of washed it a little bit, obviously very gently, it kind of evened out. But here you can see some more pieces that are a little bit underplied. It's something that's stitchable, and it's something that I will use, but it's a lesson that I learned. So then when I finally, once I realized what I was doing, I fixed the plying issue, and then this is pretty well plied, and most of it is pretty well plied, even though parts are thick and thin. Like these are plied pretty well, like at a consistent angle, so if you can see the angle. And now I spin S and ply Z. That's what's natural to me. I tried spinning Z, plying S on some of the first fiber I was spinning, and it wasn't working. Like the way that the fiber twists out of my hands, I think I just am more comfortable plying that way. And I like my outcome, so I'm not that concerned. I'm not doing it on contract where people want my yarn or whatever. This is my own, for my own personal use, I suppose. So then I ran out of yarn on 1 bobbin. So I get to the end, I'm plying, I'm like, oh, this is great, this is great. And then my right bobbin is running out of yarn and my left bobbin is not running out of yarn. And I'm like, what am I gonna do? So then I decide, well, I'm just gonna chain ply the last bit of it. So that's what I did. And I did it pretty well, so I'm not as scared anymore to chain ply. So it's only like the last bit. It didn't affect the overall weight of the yarn, because here's a chain plied bit. Come on, there we go. Let's focus. There we go. So that's chain plied, it's a 3-ply. It's a nice round yarn. So you can see the difference between a chain ply and a 2-ply. So you can see there are two strands on the bottom and then three strands wrapped around each other on the top. It makes a rounder yarn, a more uniform yarn. Even though parts are thick and thin, it's a little bit more uniform. Oh yeah, you can see right here, this is where I started chain plying. It's not as splitty because it, for crocheting at least, because the fibers aren't easily twisted apart. I don't know if you know what I mean. But anyway, so this is my final spin. I would say this is around 100 yards. Overall, it's a DK to bulky. It's still thick and thin, so it's gonna be, you know, a chunky creative cowl. But I love the color of this and I absolutely loved spinning it. You know, there are still parts in here that are overspun, but it's just a matter of me figuring out the rhythm. And I felt like eventually, like I got into a really nice rhythm. So I'm excited to stitch something with this. I'm very proud of this. This is like a really nice accomplishment. It only took me a few hours to do this. So I feel very happy about that. Even though I like stitching with singles, I think it would be too difficult for me to try and spin my own singles to crochet with them. So I definitely will be 2-plying or 3-plying yarn from here on out. So this is my spinning, yay! it brought me so much happiness this week. So I was very excited to share it today. So then let's get into some crochet. So you can see here, this is a finished gift. So please, mother-in-law, if you are watching, please look away. So, as most of you might remember, if you watched a few episodes ago, I talked about the crochet project that I was going to be doing as a gift for Christmas, and it was going to be a shawl for my mother-in-law because that's what she asked me to make her. So I started on designing a shawl, which is, you know, kind of not a semicircle, but, you know, kind of like a swooping shape. So it would be thinner on the front, you know, it would come down her arms, but it wouldn't be like this whole wrap you up and snuggle you up type thing. So I showed her what I had and the plan I had, and she's like, oh, so I'll be able to wrap myself in it. And I'm like, yeah. But the weight of yarn I was using was sport weight, so it wasn't really going to be this cozy. I mean, it was going to be cozy, but it wasn't going to be this squishy, I just want to live in this type shawl. So I was at work last week. I work and I teach crochet down at Marblehead Knits. Sorry for my nose, it's like stuffy or whatever. I teach crochet down at Marblehead Knits every Saturday, and I decided to purchase some yarn, some Ushia, which is this squishy, just lovely chainette style ultra bulky yarn, and I'm like, I'm just going to crochet her a simple shawl out of that. So this is the shawl that I crocheted for her. I can't see over it. Okay, so this is the shawl I crocheted for her. So it is a simple linen stitch shawl, and then on the edging it is a nice star stitch. So it gives this little detail. Let's see if I can show. Here we go. So this is the front, this is the right side. So you can see here we have the linen stitch and then this nice star stitch detail, because I'm all about the star stitch lately. If you don't know how to do a star stitch, you should look it up, it's really fun. So then this is the shawl that I created for her. It's a simple rectangle shawl. I'm looking at myself. And it has this nice detailing on the bottom, so it doesn't just feel like too plain. I didn't want it to feel too plain. So this is what I made for her. It is ultra squishy, ultra warm. You know, just with any crochet or knit, you know, it's going to be, there's going to be holes in it, at least with crochet. So I did the linen stitch so it wouldn't be as much. Oh, I'm on the ground. It makes me feel very old when I can't get up off the ground. So yeah, so it's just simple linen stitch. I did that because I didn't want it to be too holey for her. There you go. But this is done, and I'm very pleased with it. I think she will love it. She is going to squish up in it a lot, I feel. So, and it was a fast stitch for me because it's super bulky and I crochet like a freaking wizard. So that is that. And then the really interesting bits for knitting. I finished my first Fair Isle. So when I was at the shop, and I'm crocheting that. And I'm like, oh, I'm gonna have some leftover. I said, I wonder if I could do some Fair Isle with this. I have some chunky yarn at home. Not thinking like this is super bulky and my yarn's regular bulky, whatever. So I'm like, I don't care. I just want to practice some Fair Isle techniques because I really like color work in knit. I think it looks really cool. But I've been a little scared to do it because of my knitting style. So I'm a continental knitter. And even though I'm relatively quick with the needles and I'm relatively quick with the hook, having multiple colors and having to balance my hands in a way that I'm not used to can be frustrating for me, and I get very, like, I don't know, I just go all over the place and I'm like, I just can't do this, I don't even want to try. So I decided I was going to try, and so I did a little test knit. This was just, well, that's the back of the hat, as you can tell, but this is the front. So I decided to do like kind of a newborn size hat. So I just looked up a bulky hat pattern for just regular bulky yarn, just for the kind of beanie shape. I just wanted to know the formula. So I just bought, a pattern. So I did a few rows of ribbing for the base, simple stockinette all the way up. And then once I got where I thought it would be halfway, I started just doing a simple Fair Isle pattern. This looks like little hearts to me. I think it looks really cute. So I don't know how many rows this is, maybe 5 or 6 rows. And then I did Fair Isle, knit with one color, Fair Isle, knit with another color, Fair Isle, knit with another color. So it was like, there's one row in between each Fair Isle row. So let me show you my floats. So this was with the Ushia, which is a super bulky. So you can see it's much bulkier than the yarn that I used to knit the hat. So I think that's part of the problem. But I thought I was leaving enough room for my floats and I wasn't. So I put this on Instagram. This was the thank you picture for everybody who participated in the Small Business Saturday sale. But I was also asking for some help because I am not, you know, a Fair Isle knitter. I've never done it before. So if you see here, I'm going to demonstrate what's going to happen. So as the hat stretches, the Fair Isle kind of goes away. And it shouldn't do that. It shouldn't do that to that degree. And I don't know if it's just because the yarn is such a different weight or if it's because I didn't leave enough room for my floats. And I assumed it was because I didn't leave enough room for my floats. They feel okay, but they don't feel as loose as I feel like they should. I don't know if you know what I mean. Like, they look like they would be fine, but it's not leaving much room for stretching without losing the Fair Isle detail. So Candy from Pause for Stitches gave me some advice. I had some other advice from some other Instagram followers. Sorry, I can't remember everybody's name. So Candy suggested I looked up some techniques, which I did. And then I had some friends who, this girl Annah, she does, her Etsy shop is called Silent Knits. And she used to work down at Marblehead Knits. And I think she's in school or her husband's in school, so they moved away. But she is an awesome knitter, and so she was actually one of the people who inspired me to knit when I started down there. And so she messaged me on Facebook, and she said, Kayleen, you need to leave an extra loop, like thinking on like how much yarn I would be picking up each time I knit. She goes, you need to leave at least like another extra loop, like not enough that you're knitting, like your hand, like say this was a sleeve. You don't want your hand to get caught on the floats in the back, but you wanted to leave enough of a float so that it had enough room to stretch, at least as much as you would expect it to stretch. If it's a too small of a garment and you're stretching it too far, you're obviously going to lose the Fair Isle detail. So after she sent me that, I was like, oh, this makes sense. So what I decided to do is knit this using just, this is my bulky yarn, this is Cascade Superwash 128, so it's the same weight. Mine's a 3-ply, this is a 2-ply. It didn't make any difference in what I was doing. So I decided to try again. So I did the same amount cast on. It's hard to see here the detail because these are too close in value, but I did some yellow and then I tried to do some striping. And so when I was doing it, I felt like I had a better handle on how much I should be leaving for my floats. So this is what the inside looks like. Obviously I didn't weave in ends because this is just a test. So here it is. So these I feel like are still a tiny bit tight, but they're looser than the other hat that I had just shown you. And striping is much easier than I thought it was going to be for knitting. So here's the inside where the stripes happen. You're just carrying the yarn up. And I would do the same in crochet, so I don't know why I thought it would be any different, but I'm a new knitter, so I don't know these things. And so the technique that I was doing, so I had my knitting, right? Here's my needle. These are actually the needles I use. These are US size 10, 6mm needles. And I have the yarn. Let's pull out a strand here. So, if this was my Fair Isle stitch. Oop. Stop focusing on my face. There we go. Okay, so if this was my Fair Isle stitch, what I was doing was stretching the fabric that was on my needle that was going to pick the stitches up. So on my right hand needle, I was stretching the fabric out a little, and then I was putting my finger in to just give an extra amount before I picked up the yarn, so that I had this extra bit of space right here. So we'll pretend I'm going to do another Fair Isle stitch. So what I would do is shift my yarn, stretch where the stitches were, put my finger under the yarn, and then pick up my stitch. So then I was leaving a much more generous float, which would accommodate for any future stitches with that yarn, because when I'm knitting, you know, I'm pulling, and so I didn't want to pull too much where the float would just choop, like shrink back up again. So I wanted to leave a decent amount. So I hope that made sense what I was doing, but I was knitting and like I was just sticking my finger under it so that I was giving myself more working yarn, and then scooping my stitch up so that I wouldn't have too tight of a float. And it worked for me, and I'm a continental knitter and I do a Norwegian purl. Not that I was purling at all, but that was the most comfortable way I found. So that worked for me on this hat. So I decided to do a real hat. This was my idea to begin with. What I wanted to do was make a couple of Fair Isle hats for my kids, because I really like the way Fair Isle looks and I wanted to practice color work. My son bit this, so there's crumbs on it. Yucky. Why do you do this, child? Okay, so this is the hat I made. It's in my own dyed yarn. This is Jolly, which is the red colorway on my bulky base. And I also dyed up some holly. So these were in the shop update last week. There's still some skeins available if you wanted them. But I did Fair Isle, and I did it well enough that the stitches don't disappear. Yay! So I was going to make one in red and then one in green and get them done before Christmas. And these will be their Christmas hats. But of course, the kids want to wear it already. I have very large headed children. This is a child size, like a basic child size hat. So I don't know what the measurement should be, but my son's head is 20 inches almost. Like, it's just about 20 inches, and he's only a year old. He has a huge head. So, daddy has a large head, babies have large heads. So this is the hat. I did several rows of ribbing. I did several rows of just nothing. And I was like, okay, I'll just start the Fair Isle now. So I wanted to do this type of patterning where it looks a little bit like hearts, because I thought that looked really cute. And then I decided to do some striping here, so I just kind of went with it, with the amount of space that I had left, because I have some knowledge from crochet, you know, how tall a hat should be and how like gauge works and all of that. So I was like, well, before I start decreasing, I want to do some stripes. So I did all this striping here. So it was one stripe of white, two stripes of red, three stripes of white, two stripes of red, and then I did one row before I started decreasing where I set the colors up. So I wanted to decrease evenly around, so I did, this was 60 stitches, so I did every 6 stitches I put a red. So it was 5 and then red, 5 and a red, 5 and a red, and then the next round I did a decrease, and then so it was a decrease, knit, a decrease, a knit, and then decrease, decrease, decrease until I was done. So it was just a basic beanie shape. And I wanted to decrease with the color because I thought that would look really cool, kind of like a peppermint candy. Can you tell I have peppermint on the brain? So let me show you my floats. So this is the inside of my hat, which kind of looks really cool, I think. So these floats are pretty generous. I did not have trouble keeping the floats loose enough, especially up here at the top where I was decreasing. You can see I have pretty generous floats. It's not like they're going to be putting their hands in this, so I'm not worried about their fingers getting stuck. I did on the first decrease here, you can see I picked up, I caught the float on the next round. So the first float was 5 stitches across between the red and then the next red. So it was red, white, 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 red, white, 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 red. And so the float was kind of long. So what I did was on the third, on the next round, on the third white, I picked it up. So what happened was is I inserted my needle into the float, put it on my working needle, knit both together, and so the red would fall behind. So you can see it right here is where I picked the stitch and just tacked it down, because otherwise it was going to be from like year to year, it was going to be way too long. So that's what I did, and it worked out really well. And I decreased using the red. So every time I got to the point, so it was kind of nice, instead of using a stitch marker to mark where I was going to decrease, I had the red stitch. So once I knew I had, I was like knitting white, 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 and then I had a white red left, I would just decrease the white and red together using the red yarn. So it was really fun to do. I don't think I'll write a pattern up. I mean, I'm not a pattern writer really, but it was really fun to create this. It was just kind of random. So it fits them both really well. So I think I'm just going to make this size again, and I'll do it with the green and the white because I think I still have enough white left over. This is my leftover yarn. So you can see what I have left over. I have probably, I don't know, a quarter skein or more left of the red and at least half a skein of the white left. So I think that's plenty to do another hat to do the green skein with the white and do that patterning pattern. So do the patterning pattern. I did say that. do the Fair Isle pattern. So this I'm super proud of. So I'm like really proud of this. Whoa, I just flung that off. I'm really proud of this little malformed thing. I'm really proud of this because this is the first Fair Isle I've ever done and like a real serious knitting project. I even went so far as to try and reduce the jog. So there are techniques you can do to eliminate or disguise the jog in circular knitting. So for single rows, you can just spiral. So what will happen, because you're knitting in a spiral, if you're doing one row of color and then another row of color and one row of color, like you're going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, you can just do that. But then once you get into having more than one row of color, you start to get this jog, which you can see here. I mean, you can still see it if you're really looking for it, but it's pretty well disguised. So what happens is you can, you'll start knitting your row, and then on the following row, you're gonna pull the leg up from the previous row and then knit those together. So you're kind of shifting the fabric, so to speak. So it's not as obvious of a jog. So I even did that. I was very proud of myself for that. So I learned all these new techniques in this hat, and it made me happy. It made me very happy. Okay, so let's go to dyeing. I haven't done a ton of dyeing this week, no big surprise. I did mostly the custom orders because I had several large custom orders come in on Small Business Saturday because of the coupon I was running. So I had one order that had 10 skeins, each a different color, different things, including a gradient. So I was very busy from Saturday until Wednesday. But I did finish everything. Got everything shipped out yesterday, so anybody who is waiting for an order, everything is finally in the mail. But you know when you have those ideas and you can't sleep because you just have this idea that you really want to do and you're like, oh, will this be really cool or not really cool or whatever. So I was up at 3 o'clock in the morning one night because, well, the kids woke me up, Tucker woke me up particularly, and I was having this idea. And I'm like, I really want to do this idea. I want to get some dyeing done. I'll do all this stuff, blah, blah, blah. And then I was like, forgot about it. And then the next night I was up again and I'm like, ah, I just have to do this. So as many of you know, I do mini skein sets. I'll dye up tonals, I'll even split up big skeins into mini skeins of the colorways, right? These cute little 20, they're 20 grams a piece, plenty to do, heels, toes, cuffs, whatever you want to do. So here's a nice tonal, it's like an apple green, isn't that pretty? So I'll do solid mini skein sets. So a lot of people really like the Burrow, that's one of my most popular yarns. I've gotten so many orders for the Burrow in the last month or two. I think it's the color palette, it's really pleasing. I have Honeydukes, I have Superheroes, but it's just a collection of tonals. So you don't have to think about the colors you're picking out. I created a set with all the colors in it. So you use them for accents or heels, toes, cuffs, or use them in shawls where you have lots of color changes in shawls, like on a spice market or For the Love of Rainbows or the Floatus shawl or whatever, you know, you're using. So you can, you know, you do a lot with minis, put them in your scrap blankets. So I was like, I really want to do something interesting with sock knitting because I feel like a lot of mini skein sets feel the same. And so it's either, you know, a gradient going up or down in the same tone. You know, I have colored ones where it's like all different colors put together. And I feel like that's great. Wonderful. What are you going to do with it? You're going to stripe, you're going to do a scarf, whatever. But I wanted to do something that was really specific to sock knitting because I'm just getting into sock knitting. I have not yet cast on my first fingering weight sock, but I've done a sport weight sock and I've done a DK weight sock. And so I had some ideas. So my idea was that I wanted to do something with gradients because when you look up gradient sock weight yarn or whatever on Etsy, you know, you see those mini skein sets where it's like purple and then lighter purple and then lighter purple and lighter purple. It's like literally a gradient of skeins, which I've done before, and those are really fun to work with. But I wanted to do something about gradients because I make gradients in my shop. I knit them up, I dip them, dye them, paint them however I want. It transitions slowly from one color to another or through several colors, and they're fun. But for sock knitters, you know, sock knitters like to have some of them, a lot of them, maybe, at least the type who really like self-striping or like having matching socks. They like to have matching socks. And sometimes you can't achieve that exactly with gradients because, or not all the colors of a gradient will appear in a sock. You know, you want to use as much as you can per sock. So it's hard. And so I wanted to do something with gradients and I wanted to do something with mini skeins and I wanted to do something that was, making it easier or making it, I don't know easier if easier is the word, but making it more fun to knit socks because this is something I've never seen on Etsy. So this is something that's coming next week. I'm going to have a bunch of these sets in my shop. I'm doing mini skeins gradients, not mini skein gradients like purple, 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 purple. I'm doing new gradients within a mini skein. So this is a mini skein. I balled it up, knit it up on the knitting machine, and then graded it. So this is a purple gradient. I think this was aubergine. I'm pretty sure it was aubergine. So this is 20 grams. So if you think about a sock, if you're knitting socks, you use a 100 gram ball, you split it into 250 gram cakes, and then you're using at least 75% of that yarn to do your socks. And then sometimes you pull in a contrast color or a complementary color for heels, toes, and cuffs using 20 grams. So I thought, why not have a 5-skein mini skein set where 4 of them are gradients and 1 of them is for heels, toes, and cuffs. So that's what I did, and I'm going to show it to you as best I can. So you'd have 2 minis for 1 foot, 2 minis for your other foot, and then your contrast. So you could start knitting. I don't know if I'm going to leave these in the blank form or if I will just cake them up like this or skein them up like this. I don't know how people would want them. If you have an opinion, please let me know. I'm always interested. But because then you'll get a whole gradient in your sock. So you could start knitting from the dark end, say, and you're knitting your sock in the dark, and then you make it to the light, and then you want to put your heel in, so then you have your heel color, and then you go along and say you want to go from light to dark, so then you go light to dark and then you pop your toe color in. Does that sound like a good idea? I feel like this is a really great idea. So I posted it in Fine Yarn Connoisseurs because why not, because I'm most active in that group. And I really enjoy the opinions of the folks in that group. They're very entertaining, and they're kind of my style people. So, so you'd have two gradients for one sock. So you can do it however you want. You could alternate gradients. So you could knit from, so if you're working on one sock, you could alternate. So you could do a few rows of this, and then a few rows of this, and then a few rows of this, and a few rows of this, and kind of go along. Oops. And kind of go along like this, where you're kind of opposing gradients and kind of make opposing gradient stripes. You could do a single gradient, you could do like your cuff and then have a single gradient and then have the opposite gradient or the same gradient. Does that make sense? So that you'll actually get like a full gradient in your sock, and then you'll be able to match your socks because the gradients are identical. Or the other idea I had, which was to have two different gradients, so say like a Roy G. Biv. So like in the first gradient I would do red, orange, yellow, and then I would do yellow, green, blue, purple. Or I would do red, orange, yellow, and then do a green mini skein, and then do blue, orange, purple, and then have the green as the heels, toes, and cuffs. I don't know. Do you like that idea? I think that's a really smart idea. I'm going to release some next week. This is still in the kind of testing phase. Like, I definitely think it will work. And I think it could be really cool. So I hope you guys are with me on this. I don't know if I'm like just off in la la land in like creative mode, but I'm feeling pretty confident about this idea. Mini skein gradients. So you can, and I think it would make sock knitting kind of fun because you'll cake up this little mini, right? You'll do your cuffs and then you'll cast, you'll have your gradient, and like you could just make a whole leg of a gradient, just the whole gradient until you wanted to stop and do your heel. And then you could start the next gradient on your toe. And then even still, you could blend in. So say you ran out of yarn for your toe, but then on your, so say you ran out, you have a really big foot. And you ran out of yarn, like you did a shorter cuff, but you need a longer foot. Like you could find the point in the gradient where you ran out of yarn and kind of match up the color because they're all dyed at the same time. It's the same dye lot. So I think this is a really good idea. So I hope that you guys are on board with this. If you like the idea, you don't like the idea, let me know in the comments below. Send me a message on Ravelry, Etsy, Instagram. I don't know, I'm all the places. But I think this is a really fun idea and a fun way to get matching gradient socks without having a double-stranded cake or having it not be exact to what you want. So anyway, these are still in blank form. I don't think I'll leave them in blank form only because they're kind of like stringy. Like this is so much more compact and easy. And here's another question. Okay, I'm rambling. So here's another question. So I would put these purple ones with this green mini as a contrasting heel toe cuff. And I feel like a lot of people, that would be their taste. But I was thinking about letting you choose your own mini color, your own tonal mini, to go with the colors of the gradient. Like I would suggest some because I know the colors that I use and I know what colors look good together or what they don't look good together that would clash too much. Or you could choose like a complementary color to be your heels, toes, and cuffs. So anyway, that was my idea. It brought me lots of happiness. I have lots of happiness this week. I'm feeling in a really good mood. I'm feeling much better. I'm not sick anymore. My kids are sleeping at night. My son's finally almost done teething most of his teeth. So that was it for finished objects, works in progress, all that fun stuff. In terms of shop update, there's not gonna be a shop update tomorrow. There are trucks that always drive down my street. There's no shop update tomorrow. I have not done much dyeing this week aside from the orders that I received last Saturday. But next Saturday, I will do a shop update, and I'm going to include these mini skein sets. Most of it probably will be these mini skein sets, the gradients, because I really like that idea. So I've been kicking up tons of minis, which is a lot of work, and I'm going to be cranking up tons of minis, which will be lots of work. I'm trying to work on my musculature of my arm so that I'm not, like, dying cranking out all these mini skeins. So in terms of shop update, there are still a lot of stuff. There's still a lot of stuff left in the shop. It's not a ton, but if you missed out on the gift sets, I'm sorry. There were only 8 available, 4 in my shop and 4 in Lynn's shop, but those went like within the first 5 minutes. There's still some peppermint swirl left on different bases. There is some bulky yarn that's available. So if you're in Christmas knitting mode and you need something to inspire you, or you're looking for a specific color, there are some bulky yarns that are available. There's Holly and Jolly, which is the red and green. There is some peach blush, which is a light peachy, creamy peachy color. There is Dirigible Plums, which I showed last week. There's Overcast. I think there's still a couple of skeins of Overcast left. There's some Overcast on DK weight, the Simple DK. So if you still haven't done Christmas knitting and you're in need of yarn, there is still yarn available in my shop. So please feel free. Anything that is not in the dye to order section is ready to ship. So if you order something ready to ship, usually the same day or next day, it goes in the post office. So with post office deadlines, I believe it's the 10th or 12th that the post office guarantees shipping by Christmas. I always do my best to get, if something is placed early enough in the day, I usually go the same day to the post office to mail it. I live in a small town, so it's easy enough for me to just go in the afternoon, get all the packages that have been ordered, and ship them out, which is usually what happens. Or you can always expedite your shipping. So if you're nervous about a deadline, or you need it by a certain time, you're always welcome to upgrade your shipping. That's always an option in Etsy, where you can, instead of just going first class package, you can do priority package if you wanted. So it might get to you a little bit faster. But yeah, so anything that's ready to ship in the, you know, the styles where it says like Simple DK, Sparkle Sock, blah blah blah, those are all ready to ship yarns. And usually the first line of the description says, this is ready to ship on Sparkle Sock base, this is ready to ship as a sock blank, this is ready to ship. So anything ready to ship goes out. Anything that's dyed to order, I usually dye within a couple of days, depending on my queue length. So this weekend I had an extremely long queue, so it took me about 3 to 4 days to get through all of the yarn that I needed to dye. On my shop, and in terms of like shipping policy, I, you know, usually say up to 5 to 7 business days to process an order, and that's a gross overestimate usually for the amount of volume. I am a one-woman show, but most of the time I'm able to dye something same day and ship it next day. So if anything changes from that, I'm always one to message on Etsy immediately to say like, this is my queue length, this is about how long you have to wait for your yarn to ship. And I'm pretty good about keeping to that timeline. So I'm a pretty organized person despite having this crazy, you know, life with kids and husbands and Christmas and all this stuff going on. So I take this very seriously. I'm very serious about customer service. I don't know. Anybody who really knows me or who has had exchanges with me in person through messages, in person, not that I've met any of you. I mean, I met Lynne, which I'll talk about in a minute, but anybody who's had connections with me through my Etsy shop or my Instagram, or has chatted with me or asked me questions, like, I'm pretty open, and I'm very much about customer service and making sure that I keep to my word and I make sure that you get what you need in a timely fashion. So that's just me. That's all for shop update. In terms of personal life updates, I have a couple things to chat about. Not a ton, but you know, a couple things. So I met with Lynne last week of the Sunshine Bubblegum podcast. Hi Lynne and her sister. They came to town and they wanted to see Marblehead Knits, so I was like, oh, I'll meet you down there. cranky baby did not allow me to stay there for very long. So I said, just come to my house and we're just gonna hang out and chat and just have fun. And you can see my yarn stash. Do you wanna see my yarn stash? You know, you wanna see where I dye all the yarn? I was getting ready actually for a dye that day to do some more peppermint swirl on multiple bases. So I had like my big stock pot out, I had all the pans out and the dye ready to go. The kitchen was clean and they came to my house and they're like, are you gonna dye right now? I'm like, yes, but not right now. Let's just sit and visit and have fun. So we sat and chatted for like an hour, which was wonderful. Lynne, you're so nice and your sister's so nice. And it was just really nice. Like, it just felt like meeting up with old friends. And I hope that everybody who watches this feels that way. Like, if you ever met me, like, it would feel like meeting up with an old friend, you know, just something very casual, happy, because that's generally how I am, despite being sleep deprived. Yeah, so it was just so nice. It was like, I don't know, it felt like I was meeting somebody that I had known for a very long time. Even though I haven't known Lynne for a very long time, or have been chatting with her for a very long time, it just, you know, when you meet someone and you just feel like you click and you're like, oh yeah, welcome to my house. You've never really met me before, but you can come over to my house and hang out and play with yarn, and here you go, have some yarn. Like, let's just do that. So it was so, so, so fun. And so we had Thanksgiving, and my brother came, and my mother came, and my brother-in-law and his girlfriend came, and it was quite lovely. I'll put a little picture up here if I feel like editing this part, but they just came out and hung, and we played. We got a Nintendo Classic. So we played on the Nintendo Classic for a while after dinner. We hosted, my husband and I, so we did all the cooking, but everything came out delicious. And yeah, it was just so fun. It was the way holidays should be. You know, at this time of year, it's kind of notorious for being like all families collide and there's all this drama and problems and, oh, you don't talk to so-and-so, or I wasn't invited to so-and-so's party. And like, in my family, I feel very thankful that I am not part of any drama, that we just get together and we enjoy each other's company and are thankful for each other. And, you know, I feel like that's what this season is all about. So very thankful to have that, and I'm very thankful to have my health and happiness and to have my family here and able to come visit me. So it's wonderful, it's wonderful. It's that time of year. And then Friday we put up our Christmas tree. I'll try and put in some footage of our Christmas tree, but we did put it up. It's right here in the corner. I had to move my yarn station out of the way. It was fun to decorate with the kids on the day after Thanksgiving. My daughter was very excited and she's like, this is my Christmas tree. I said, yeah, we're gonna go out and get a star, and we had to get a new tree skirt, and we had to get some more ornaments because we can't put the glass ones on because of Tucker this year. So that was really fun. Cece enjoyed it. She got daddy a little BB-8 ornament. It was a special thing. Yeah, so we're all in the Christmas spirit, the holiday spirit, just of the whole entire season, no matter what holiday you celebrate. This season is about being thankful for what you have, being happy and together with family, to feel love from other people, to give to other people. That's what this really is about. So that's how I am anyway. So anyways, I'll chat with you guys next week. I hope you have a fantastic weekend. So again, no shop update tomorrow, but the following Saturday, which I think is the 10th of December, I will have a shop update. So that will be good to go, and just keep an eye on my Instagram, social media. That's where I usually announce update times. Last time it was at 9 a.m., which is a little early for my Pacific folks. I'm sorry if you were trying to get up super early to score something. So I think I may do it at 1 o'clock again, because that's just, it seems like a nicer time. Like, it's not too late in Europe and it's not too early in the West Coast, so I feel like that might be a better time. So I think I'll end up doing it at 1. Okay, I'll do it at 1. I'm announcing it. I'm gonna do it next Saturday at 1. Anyway, have a great weekend, and I will see you guys in my next video. Bye!